Hello, everybody. My name is Chris O'Brien, and I'm a visitor services guide here at the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania. And I want to welcome you to the first part of a two-part series on our Model Railroading Day Zoom presentation. This first part of the video features Doug O'Brien, a museum volunteer, as he takes you on a trip around the middle division layout and what it takes to maintain such a complex layout. Enjoy.
So we are recording now. And again, welcome to Model Railroad Day. We really appreciate you joining us. Today we do have two sessions scheduled. The first is our presentation on the middle division layout featuring volunteer Doug O'Brien. Our second session on the Model Railroaders Toolkit will begin at 2:30 p.m. And we do ask again that you keep your microphone muted. Use the chat feature to share those questions and comments. I will do my best to keep up with any of the questions that do come in during the program. And if for some reason I'm not able to answer immediately, I will get your question to Doug at the conclusion of the session. Now, Doug O'Brien has been a volunteer at the Railroad Museum since 2014 and was recognized as the Railroad Museum's Volunteer of the Year in 2016. Doug has championed the Pennsylvania Middle Division layout and has worked with a number of other volunteers who join him in keeping this exhibit running. Doug is also a member of the FRM Board of Directors and has contributed his time and talents to many of the museum's special events. We thank him for joining us today and for sharing his knowledge of the layout with us. And so at this time, I will go ahead and turn the session over to Doug to let him share the middle division layout with you.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, or good morning, depending on where you are. We hear we have somebody from Iowa. I suspect that that's our volunteer, George Schwartz, who's visiting out there, if that is. Hi, George. In any case, I'd like to introduce you to the middle division of the Pennsylvania Railroad in miniature. What you're looking at right now is a stretch of the railroad that ran between Lewistown and Denholm. We'll come to Denholm in a minute. We have four mainline tracks. The first two, 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1 and 2 are eastbound, 3 and 4 are westbound. And over here we have the Sunbury line, which I'll come back to after a bit. Now, we also have 7 trains running today. We can run 9, but only 7 today. And they are a mix of freight and passenger. Passenger trains on the main line in the middle division ran on tracks 1 and 4. And the difficulty, as you see, 1 and 4 freights ran on 2 and 3. We have alternating freights on 2 and 3 today, one of which, as you can see, is stalling from time to time. It's just like a model railroad anywhere. As soon as you're ready for open house, things start to knock down, even though they worked perfectly the day before. Anyway, let's go this way, if I may. The first thing I'd like to show you is we have 3 working signal bridges. The bridges themselves were made by Spaceways, and the heads come from New Jersey, and the heads come from New Jersey International. We wired them ourselves. These are 3D printed. They cost about $100 each if you're in the market for that sort of thing. And they are very, very fragile, but we have to be very careful in how we put them together. As you can see, we're using the position light aspects for the trains on all 4 major tracks. Coming down the entrance to the Denholm complex. Now, these lead tracks going back and forth on either side of Denholm, the coal wharf, in real life are 1.5 miles long. We don't have that kind of space, so as a consequence, our freight trains are a little shorter than we'd otherwise like to show prototypical length. So the freight trains run 25 cars. Our passenger trains, however, are prototypical. They are real ones, and they are the correct length. As you can see, we have on track 4 here an accommodation train, as Pennsylvania Railroad called them. They were a local for everybody else. They essentially were like a small airline puddle jumpers, we call them euphemistically, that would go from small airport to small airport, deposit passengers at a main terminal, and from there they would get their international flights. It was the same concept. The local would stop everywhere, deposit people at the bigger depots where they could catch a intercity train, or a limited, as the Pennsylvania called them. Now, moving down this way, We have some landscaping things we're still working on. This is going to be a pasture. There will be cows grazing in there when it's done. We're doing a reforestation project also. Jim Hunter, a name that may be familiar with to you. He is the editor of the Keystone Modeler, and he is a volunteer here also. And he is working on all of the landscaping and trying to make it come up a little bit more to our standard. The yard going into Denholm, and you can see I've got an engine that seems to have lost its consist. We'll have to examine that in a minute. In any case, this train is static at the moment to show you that sometimes if the train was too long, the engine had to detach and back under a slot for homework and get it serviced that way. Then it would come back up to the front of the train, recouple, and move on. The coal wharf, this massive thing, built in 1906. It only took four people to operate, and it sounds to me like we have a wreck on the other side of the layout. So let's go over there and get that repaired before we talk about anything further. Wrecks do happen on our layout. Oh, and we have an end. So I'm actually, to deal with this, I'm actually going to show you the number one most frequently asked question we have, and that's how do we get in and out. We built the gate. When we move the layout from downstairs up here, so we can swing this open. I have to make an adjustment here, or I'm going to move some cars. That shuts all the power off, and we can swing this open and walk easily in and out. I mentioned George Schwartz's name earlier. He was the guy who designed this for us. It was built in the shop here in the museum. So I can go in and out with equipment in and out as necessary. Over here, just shut the power off on 2 and 3 for a while. We see what happened in the wreck. Come this way. Walking away from you with cameraman Pat Morrison, the director of the museum. Oh, it's nasty. Bunch of empty hoppers, which were probably being pushed because they lost their locomotive. Right. So while I get these organized, and we've also split that. This is Mifflin while we're doing the tour, the quick tour. Mifflin is a small town in central Pennsylvania. The layout is set between Mifflin and Lewistown. We haven't come to Lewistown yet. We've lit the buildings here because this area has to remain in perpetual twilight because around the walls here are original Griftel paintings. A number of them, you may recognize the one on the far right over there, that is a license plate in Pennsylvania. These need to be protected from harsh light, and that's why we keep this area dim. It works perfectly so we can light the town, and that worked out very nicely for us. At this end, I might as well keep going around while I'm holding these cars, we'll fix them later. We have, in Mifflin was a taconite mine. We have a taconite, I'm sorry. We're converting it to a coal mine to illustrate that the Pensy would pick up coal from a mine, take it to Denholm, and dump it so that trains could be serviced there. They would get a constant flow of coal coming from area mines and so forth, and yards full of loaded hoppers. And then as we come through around this way, you can see we have the Granville Bridge. This is the freight train that ran into those derailed hoppers with the Juniata River flowing underneath. And then finally, we come to Lewistown. Now, Lewistown was a major stop for the Pensy. It's a major stop for Amtrak today. It's the only one in central Pennsylvania, as a matter of fact. All trains stopped here. Only the locals, I should say, the accommodation trains stopped in Mifflin. So we've got it organized that way. This train, which is the American, which ran daily between New York and St. Louis, will stop in Lewistown. The accommodation train will stop both in Lewistown and in Mifflin. The station is an accurate representation of what the building looks like. Indeed, it's still there. It is now the archive for the Pennsylvania Historical and the Pennsylvania Railroad Technical and Historical Society. And it's a busy place as a consequence. And as I said, Amtrak still stops there. What you're looking at here in Lewistown is no longer there. The town is certainly there. It's back behind where the backdrop would be. But most of what you see here is gone. And where you see the grade crossing, that's been replaced now by an overpass, so people don't have to wait for trains to go by. Three things were manufactured and still are manufactured in Ocean City, in fact, entirely. Three products came from Lewistown and still do. Lewistown was the second, and I believe still is, second biggest producer of railroad wheel sets and wheels, and we have that represented with some gondolas loaded with them. It's also a, or was, a mining center for limestone. So we have that represented here. And the one we're working on, to this day, New Holland Agricultural makes square balers there. And it was in the late 40s and early 50s, as we represent here, and it still is today. Now we're still looking for models of those so that we can load up some flat cars with them. And that would represent another product from Lewistown. Now back here, we have a string of hoppers. These are anthracite. Most of the coal the Pennsy moved was bituminous, but anthracite was transshipped across the Pennsylvania Railroad, mined in northeastern Pennsylvania. It came down through Sunbury and to Lewistown. So that's why the purpose of the Sunbury line. And then it was transshipped on to steelmaking facilities, mostly in Johnstown, Pennsylvania. And Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, although the Bethlehem steel plants would have used most of that product right there in northeastern Pennsylvania. So we tried to represent throughout the layout things that really did happen and did occur during the late 40s and early 50s when this is set. As I said, this is a daily train from St. Louis to New York. This one is New York bound. And as you can see, we don't have it lit yet. We're working on lighting for everything. But we do have some interiors in there, and eventually that'll all be done. So particularly the children, when they stand here, they're almost eye level with these cars. They'll be able to look in when it stops and say, oh my, there were really people in there, and they did travel, which was a very, and this was still a very popular train up until the mid-50s to early 60s. The other, as I said, train was the accommodation that would stop here. People would get off, and they would come over, either wait on this platform, come across, depending on which way they were going, and through a subway. There was a staircase that went down under the tracks, came up behind near inside this building, so people could get across without killing themselves going on the track. Now that subway in this particular situation doesn't exist anymore, but there was one in Mifflin, and that is still there. So that's pretty much where we are, and then you take it back around. Now what happens on the Sunbury line, and we'll go inside the layout so you can see the continuation of it, it runs, comes out here, and we need to do some landscaping so to hide it behind the roundhouse over there. But it comes through, collects its cars, and then continues up this way. Pat, if you'll follow, we can go around and see that layout, or see how that works, I should say. And it comes through here, and then goes behind the backdrop here. Now there's a two-track yard back there. I'm gonna put these cars down and start the trains up. Is our workbench. It comes through here, comes through the backside, and we have a two-track yard, and then it continues on the backside over here and continues on around. How this is organized is that one train is inbound to Lewistown, the other one is outbound. They get to this yard, the switches throw, the polarity changes, and on the go. So this train, for example, will go around that way, come through here and stop, and then this one goes that way. So you get the in and out. There was all kinds of things that moved in and out of Lewistown. It wasn't just anthracite coal. It was a general freight line. And I might mention for you historians who are interested, the Sunbury line was where in-cab signaling was first tested in the United States. And that was where the systems were developed that subsequently were used by all the railroads throughout the United States. Our power is here. This is a DC layout. It is not DCC. We had a very long talk amongst ourselves about what we wanted to do. We decided that because this layout operates all the time and it doesn't really, we don't do any switching per se, and we don't do any operation in the traditional a model railroad sense. We just need things to go all the time. So this is set up, 6 power packs, 6 different tracks, total of 9 trains when everything is running, pardon me, and a number of switches that we can preset to make the whole thing behave in a certain way. Now, all of the circuit boards you see here and all these switches, again, George Schwartz very integrally involved in all of that, but the hardware and the design came from Azotrax in Colorado. Azotrax has been very, very helpful to us in getting these things to work, and we've been in kind of a test lab for them in some respects, I suppose. Anyway, they've been very good about helping us fit our particular needs. So if you've got a large layout and you're looking for something help like that, that might be a place for you to go. Lots of stuff. Is there a model railroad anywhere that doesn't have lots of stuff? We've got stuff. And as you can see, we outgrew our brand new workbench 2 years ago very quickly. Stuff at the top, the engines at the top, new motors and so forth. This is our workspace. We have a power pack here that operates this test track so we can test on things, see how things are going. This engine, working great, stopped. Don't know why. Have to look into that later. And as I said, we've had a problem with that hopper train. Now, I wanted to talk about lighting for a minute. All of the cabin cars, as Pennsylvania called its cabooses, have working marker lights. But there are common 2 kinds. One is the traditional track pickup, run it to 2 LEDs with a bridge rectifier and a resistor wired in series. That's okay. It blinks a lot when there's any dirt on the track at all. Typically, that's not a big problem here because trains run so much. Otherwise, though, we have some of them that operate on a battery. It's a watch battery. Here it is. For those of you who are interested in these kinds of things, this is a 2032, which fits into a device like this. For the cabin cars, it's just that part with socket. For the passenger cars, 5 LEDs. This is manufactured by Train Tech in Britain. We're putting these in to see how they go. When the museum opens up, we'll be running trains again, as we typically do, 8 hours a day, 6.5 days a week. That's a lot. And we need to have lights that don't quit on us. The issue is, how long does the battery last? We don't know. So as a consequence, we're going to try it out for a year, see how it is. Now, if we only have to change the battery once a year, that's good. We can deal with that. In which case, all the lighting would be switched over to that kind of a system, simply because it's a lot less bother and a lot more reliability. Otherwise, however, we're going to experiment also with several lighting systems in a different passenger train, such as you see on track 1 here, and put different lighting systems in that train to see how that works. So we're doing some laboratory work in that regard, and I can't say what you're looking at right now is exactly what we're going to stick with. We're also trying it in the locomotives. The headlight in the E7 on track 1 is battery powered, but the others are track pickup. We don't have them all installed yet. Some, we also have incandescent lamps in some of them, and we have LEDs in some of them. Again, it's a question, we're gonna look at it for a while, see which one we like. That's typically how we do things in virtually every respect here. Anyway, so let's get running again, if I may, even with our truncated system. Close the gate. Have to keep it locked, we ordinarily do, because little kids, of course, they'll be all over it. The nice thing about the Train Tech system, by the way, is that the lights, like you can see on this cabin car, will stay lit for a certain amount of time and then go out. They have motion detectors in them, so as soon as the train starts up again, they'll light up. In our case, because trains stop for 30 to 45 seconds, depending, or a minute, or sometimes 2 minutes, they'll stay lit. And that's a very nice way for things to operate. Now, let me make sure that I didn't crash something over here beside us. One. Yep, I did. So bear with me while I make a repair. Be real. Now I have to check and see if in fact we cut the power. the gauge then, just to make sure that number two starts up. But I need to detach the train again. We've lost a few cars for getting to separate things at the gate. In fact, one of our short nose diesels went that way one afternoon. So just like everybody else, I guess you lose one on the floor from time to time. Right. So this loaded coal train will make a circuit. I'm going to park these on track two, and then it will, that is the working train, will come around and park under Denholm. The switches will throw, and then the mixed freight behind those trucks will start up. I have to open the gate once again, because what I can do is I have the option to operate either of the alternating tracks, two and three, as just a single track. And that's what I'm going to do, throw a switch so that the mixed freight on track three will keep going around. Now, I'm going to close this again. That should be what occurs. Except I know I have to do one little thing. Just a second. Let's see if that works. Understand, this has been shut off for 6 months. None of us are road scholars, okay? So we forget how things work exactly. So it takes us a little while to get reacquainted with it. I'm going to come around behind your back. The switches are correctly set, so we shouldn't have a collision when the mixed brake comes around on track three. Just need to make sure it's still going. Here at the train on track two moving now, and it is a growler, just like they used to call the diesels in the early days. By the way, one of the most frequently asked questions we get is what products do we have? This is an old model tower. I've forgotten what they used to call them, but it's the 2000 variety as opposed to the one. The engine on the passenger E7, same thing. The sharks are Broadway Limited imports. The steam is all brass. We have found that typically brass is the easiest to repair, lasts the longest, and gives us the best service. Now, we do have some others. We have some old Bowsers, and we have some Broadway Limited import steam also that we use in the backup situation. But fundamentally, we rely on brass steam, and to the extent we can, the life, diesels, because they give us the best service and the easiest to repair, and that's what we prefer. Now, when we get a new diesel or a new steamer, the first thing we do is take all the guts out. We remove all the DCC stuff and make it a straight circuit, and we find that that is a lot more reliable in this kind of an application. We have lots of people we know of that swear by DCC, that it never goes bad. They love it, and they'll continue using it forever. Okay, good. Not going to argue with that, but in our case, we've discovered that it works best with all of that electronics taken out of it. We are in the process of reinstalling the headlights. We don't run sound because it's loud enough in here as it is. You couldn't be able to hear anybody talking. We do answer questions from visitors and so forth, so we need to be able to hear. So all of that comes out. Again, this is not how a lot of people do things. We're not attempting to be the end all of anything. It's how we do it, and it works for us. Everybody's got their own way of doing things, and that's just fine. Now, why do I have a part of a freight train here? Right. Faster than a wrecking crew could go. But obviously, this is the remains of the empty hopper train that derailed. So I will dispose of these back. Thank you. sprinklers all the way. Now come with me again. I want to show you one other feature here. Probably notice that mixed braid on track 3 is running too fast. I can fix that obviously by turning it down, but how would I know when it's correct? I'll show you that. We have a speedometer. Joe Pellinchar, one of our volunteers, found this. It shows track 1 passed last train by, and it went 68 miles an hour, which is about prototypical for this area at that time. Now, let me close the gate, and we'll test the other four. And the other three tracks, okay. Now, here comes track 3, which is too fast, doing 54 miles an hour. So I'm going to run that down a bit. We'll see what it does when it passes again. That's probably a little too slow. Next train to come by. There's the accommodation train stopping in Lewistown. So the next one coming by is the American on track 1. Had a consistent 68, that's good. And the accommodation train doing 60, that's good. And here we have a coal train pulled by sea liners. It's making 30 for a coal train, that's pretty good. Although if you've been to the middle division nowadays, coal trains fly through there about 70. Or at least that's what it seemed like when I saw one. So now we want to just see how that mixed freight coming through behind the FA2s is going to do. The sea liners, by the way, are also like Proto 1000. The FAs and the E7s are Proto 2000. That's much better than 54. That's much more prototypical. So we'll leave it there. And then what we usually do is we have this faced out so visitors can see it and they can understand what kind of speeds these trains operated at during the period that we're talking about here. Now you may have noticed in that mixed freight going by that there were three refrigerator cars in the front. Let's go back out. We can get a better look at the trains themselves. Sure that I'm not going to drop anything. Right. And it'll all start up again. So when the mixed freight comes by, you'll notice the first three cars are refrigerator cars. I have seen one picture in my entire life of a unit train of refrigerator cars on the Pennsylvania. Lots of them on the Santa Fe, but never in the Pennsylvania. Typically, what the Pensy would do is take a block of cars and put them in a freight train bound for a certain specific location, not take an entire block of unit train and break it up in an Ola or something like that. So here you have the three on the front. Refrigerator cars always in the front. Your merchandise and whatnot in the bulk loads in the middle. And if you had any empties, they would be on the end. So we have an empty on this train. You can see we even have a hobo sitting in it. Get a better look at that later, perhaps. So empties were at the back of the train. Perishables or stock cars were in the front of the train because they would need to be switched out to rest the stock, to re-ice the refrigerator cars and so forth. The rest of it didn't need that kind of treatment. And the cars you're going to switch out, you want at the front, it's just easier to handle that way. And the empties, would be going back to a destination. They would have the longest run of anything in most cases. You might also notice that on the accommodation train, which is going under Denholm right now, we have a baggage car on the front and we have a combination car on the back. So frequently in these, you had a baggage section at the front of the train and at the back of the train. And this was so you didn't have to turn the whole train. And one of the baggage section at the front, so in this particular case, that B60 is what's being used for express or baggage or small freight, whatever. And then when it gets to, in this case, Altoona, it'll turn the engine, send it back to Harrisburg, it'll couple up on the front of that train, and then the baggage compartment and the accommodation car is what will be used for that purpose, eastbound. A bit more about Denholm. As I said, it only took 4 men to operate. What a steamer would do when it came through here and in busy times with only steam and no diesel, you would have up to 140 trains being operated in a day. Oops. The plate there. Again. 140 steam engines would be serviced every day at Denholm. Only 4 men operated the thing. It did run 24 hours a day. A steamer would pull in, tender under the dock. There is an inspection pit underneath. Somebody would be in there as the engine ran over it. He would give it an underneath inspection. A full load of coal, a full load of water, and a full load of sand in 3 minutes. He's on his way. That was optimal. Most of the time they spent 15 to 20 minutes doing all of that. And locomotive engineers on freight trains would compete for speed so they could get in and out. And they could, it's like going into the pits at a racetrack, the Indy 500. You want your service as fast as you can so you can maybe get out in front of the one who came in just ahead of you. Sometimes that worked, sometimes it didn't. But anyway, they would urge fast service so they could get a move on as fast as possible. Eastbound trains almost never stopped here because they would get a full load of coal and water and sand in Altoona, and they would go to Harrisburg or Enola, depending on passenger or freight. It's all downhill. So they were not using as much of their fuel as otherwise would be the case, but virtually every single westbound freight train and passenger train stopped here to top up their load so they could move on. Turn to the right there, Pat, you can see we have our train running, the coal hopper being pushed by an H6, which was the standard locomotive used on this for this service as far as we know, and it would bring a full load of coal up here to the wharf. In reality, the hopper would be detached immediately and the engine would back down, and then the hopper is connected to a winch, and the winch would pull it to precisely the correct dumping point. Well, we can't get that sophisticated, but what we do have in mind is having this engine move the hopper probably over here and dump in one of these holes like we have in these two spots. It would go through the hopper underneath and into a tender with a hole cut through it. The old bowsers were hollow, we have one, and through the inspection pit and into a receptacle underneath, big enough so that we only had to do this once a week, that is, change it out. What we've not yet figured out is how to get the loads working in the mine. We've got a basic theory, but we don't know if that'll work yet. That will be tested probably in the coming year. That's one of our big projects coming up. Otherwise, finish the lighting is what we've got in mind. Finish the landscaping. As you can see, that's going to be a big job. People have asked what these trees are made of. They're actually just sticks. And then there is a foliage material that comes in a package about this big, and you just spread it out and spread it across the top. But as you can see, in many instances where you see sticks showing, that's because it does sink. So every now and then you have to lift it back up. Now, we may do that in some places. We haven't decided yet, but Jim Hunter, as I indicated earlier, who's doing most of our landscaping for us, is very interested in getting real trees in wherever possible, that is individual ones, built and glued properly, and have those on the layout. And these kinds of trees that you see here, we can push into the back. They get dusty. There is a product, however, that does clean it without having to do anything other than spray them, and that is, you can go to a flower shop and get a spray bottle of cleaner for artificial plants, and that does work very nicely to keep these dust free. We've got a layer on there now, but we're not going to be working on that in the immediate future, not cleaning it, because we'll be making some changes there and so forth. Now I've got something that's not happening. What's going on here? I hear noise, but I don't see anything operating. Oh, it's stuck. There we go. And there are perpetual bugs. We can go for months, truly months. The place operates like a song. Everything is absolutely perfect. And then we can go to, we'll have weeks on end where nothing looks right. I'm inclined to say, well, it's 2020. What did you expect? But I'm not sure that's entirely fair. Nevertheless, again, we haven't run it for 6 months. We did some testing yesterday, and that was it. So when the museum reopens, we get back in here, we're going to work on some stuff and get this thing really going well. Late last year, or earlier this year, I should say, just before the closure, we changed out the brackets that were holding the layout up at either end of the gate from wood to metal. Those brackets that were wood moved a lot. And that's unacceptable. There was expansion, contraction, so forth, because then all the alignment would change. Well, now that we've got steel in there, we've got to realign these tracks, and we won't have to do that again. But it's going to be a job to get them aligned now. But knowing that we don't have to do it again will be a big plus. That, I think, is the basics of everything. We have our storage closet here. We keep lots and lots of stuff. We have more than we could possibly use when people donate things to us. We will go through and select and see if there's something we can use. And if not, then it goes ultimately to sale, which is what keeps the auction value of what we're able to sell is what keeps this layout going. We are pretty much self-sustaining. We do use museum money from time to time, but most of the time it is what we make from our auctions. We are all volunteers. This is not a club. And if you are anywhere near us, even as far away as Virginia, Maryland, New Jersey, where some of our volunteers come from, and you'd like to participate in this and help out, watch for the museum reopening and then get a hold of Liz Myers, who introduced us this morning or this afternoon, and she'll talk to you about some of the work on a volunteer basis here, be part of the crew, work on this layout. We all really do enjoy it. We have a lot of fun. Six to eight of us that work on it with great regularity, come from all kinds of backgrounds, and we can certainly have more folks do that as needed. I'm here almost every day. I'm getting to an age where maybe I'd rather not be. Come in four times a week instead of five. So have somebody here on the weekend perhaps with mind things. Just mind the store and make sure everything's working and learn how to do things. And we could probably make it even more interesting than it is today. On that, I don't think I have anything else that comes right off the top of my head. I'd be happy to answer any questions if there are any.
Wonderful. Doug, thank you so much for the tour of the middle division layout. And as he said, if anyone has some questions for Doug, we do welcome you to turn your mic on at this time and send those to him.
And that's all good. While I'm waiting for questions, if Pat wants to go around, just give you some general overviews of the layout, that's fine. If you see anything that prompts a question, let Liz know and she'll answer it. In the meantime, I'll see if I can get my hopper train running. My empty hopper's running again. I don't know what caused that derailment. I have an engine here that arrived by itself and left its train back in Mifflin. So I'll see if I can figure out what's going on in the back. Otherwise, thank you all very much for looking in. I hope you found it interesting. And remember also that this is not a tip. I wanted to say this at the front. I don't think I did. This is not a typical layout. This is a museum demonstration. What we're trying to do here is show people the kind of activity that occurred on the middle division historically, wherever possible, during the late 40s and early 50s when it was at its busiest. So we don't do a lot of the things that other modelers do, and we do things that they would never do. I'm not saying what we do is correct. I'm not saying how we fix things or how we operate things is correct. It's what works for us only. If it works for you, great. If it doesn't, fine. Let us know what you're doing, and perhaps we could use your skills to make this even better. We'd be always grateful to know that sort of thing. But as I say, it's DC, and that's where I was going to stay, because it just makes a lot more sense in our environment. We do take a little modeler's license. The Takamite mine, instead of the being a coal mine, switching to coal is an example of that. But again, part of our mission is to illustrate and educate, and we want to show how things work, and so we have to make some changes and things to make that possible.
Doug, we do have one question about structures. Are they mostly built from kits, or are they mostly scratch built?
Yes, thank you. And I'll drop back a little bit on that, Liz. The structures are all scratch built. I shouldn't say that. There are a couple out of the box resin buildings. This layout was built for a gentleman in Lewistown in about 2002, as I recall, by a company called Rail Dreams out of Florida. The company is no longer in business. It was about a third again, maybe a half again, bigger than this. It was in its own building, and it ran around the walls with a long branch line and a peninsula in the middle. Unfortunately, the gentleman who had it built for himself died not altogether too long afterward, and the layout was then dismantled, and his estate gave it to the museum. It was brought here in 2010, roughly.
Six or seven,
sorry.
Yeah.
And it was on the first floor, and it didn't work very well. Rail Dreams came in, put it back together, and so forth. It didn't work very well. But in 2018, we moved it up here. And I'm delighted to tell you that it took exactly one day to take the whole thing apart and bring it up here and put it in here. So that's a long way of getting around to the fact that when this layout was built by Rail Dreams, everything on it was correct for the location. So each building that you see was scratch built to mimic another building in another place, be it Lewistown or Mifflin. There was one difference in Mifflin, however, is that the commercial section of Mifflin is actually two blocks away from the train station. So they condensed that to bring it up and so everybody could see it. But the buildings were correct for what was in Mifflin at that time. So all of these buildings are scratch built, including that coal wharf. You can't get that in a kit anywhere. And so we are very, very, very delicate with it, because if we break something and it can't be fixed, we're kind of out of luck. So we're kind of careful with that. So everything is, yes, the buildings are all scratch.
Wonderful, thank you.
Here's an exception. This one, you can see that this shack has fallen down. That's just resin.
Wonderful. As Doug said, the middle division was originally in the lobby of the Railroad Museum, but when it moved up to the second floor, we kind of came full circle. Many, many years ago in the 90s, the original Pennsylvania Landscapes modular display was located in this gallery, and then it was eventually relocated to the Education Center. So we've connected our loop and brought model trains back to the second floor gallery. And the work our volunteers have done on this exhibit is really remarkable, as you might imagine. It takes a lot of work to keep this running as consistently as they've been able to have it run for us. Most model railroads do not run almost 365 days a year for hours and hours and hours each day. So we're so grateful for their work and the time and effort they put into making this a great exhibit for our visitors. So that is probably the conclusion of our first session. We do hope everyone will be able to come back and join us at 2:30 p.m. for our second session. That is a Model Railroaders Toolkit. The presenter for our second session is Ryan Kunkel, the Director of Production at Lionel and the former Visitor Services Supervisor at the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania. So for now, enjoy a short break and we will see you back here in a little bit.